Well, thank you very much for the invitation to come here. It's always a pleasure to come to Rio. Oh, my talk is the other way around. Yeah. Okay, so my talk is called Gerbs on G2 Manifolds. We will be hearing a few talks on G2 Manifolds, three, I think. So I'll give you a good amount of introduction to them. So
Gerbs on G2 Manifolds.
So the first part of my talk is basically background from G2 geometry. Then I'll get more into gerbs, which it's not what I do for a living, but I noticed this thing I'm telling you today about. So my first task is to tell you what it means for a three form in seven dimensions to be positive, OK? So the first thing I'm going to do is to tell you how to construct a vector cross product in R7 as the one we have on R3. What I'll do is that I'll use the isomorphism. So I'm going to think of R7 as the imaginary octonions. And I'm going to use the way how we use, how we think of R3 as the imaginary quaternions to define the vector cross product. But just know that I will use the octonions. So I'll say that if U and V are two vectors in R7, I'm going to say that the cross product of U and V is the imaginary part of the octonion multiplication of U and V. Okay? So this satisfies the three things you would ask a vector cross product to satisfy. So it is antisymmetric. If you take the cross product of U and V, that's orthogonal to U, and it's also orthogonal to V due to this one. And this parallelogram area thing, that the norm square of the vector U cross V is the area of the parallelogram spun by them, which is norm U square, norm V square, minus the inner product of U and V square. Okay. And it follows from 1 and 2 that I can define this. Well, I can always define this three tensor, which is U cross V inner product with W. And it follows from 1 and 2 that this is alternating. So it's a three form. This phi naught is a three form in R7. So it's alternating. So of course, GL7R acts on R7. That induces an action on the three forms in R7. So I can think of the orbit of this phi naught under that action. I'll call that lambda 3 plus. So it's the GL7R, so this is a 7, orbit of phi naught. Of course, this is in lambda 3. And one interesting fact about it is that this orbit is open. Okay. And for me, G2, the Lie group G2, is defined as the stabilizer of this three form. So are the elements of GL7R that leaves it stiff, fixed. And the three form in lambda 3 plus is called positive. Okay. And the connection with Riemannian geometry comes now, is that if I have a positive three form, that defines to me, in a nonlinear way, a Riemannian metric. So this defines a Riemannian metric G phi. If you take phi naught here, for example, that metric is the Euclidean metric on R7. Okay. And I'm going to define now a G2 manifold. So X7 phi is a G2 manifold if, well, so, well, let me rephrase this as follows. So X7 phi with X7 oriented and phi, which must also be spin, but that follows also from this condition I'm writing. Phi needs to be a lot a lot more things. So phi and everywhere. Positive. Three form is, so this pair with this is a G2 manifold if, so the following equations hold. So phi must be closed. And now there is a nonlinear equation, which is that d star phi must also, so phi must also be co-closed. And this is nonlinear because I'm using the odd star given to me by this Riemannian metric. Okay, so this is a nonlinear equation. Okay. So a proposition to relate this again, to see more or less what this tell me about the Riemannian metric G phi that I have on my manifold, is that the following things are equivalent. So the following are equivalent. One, X7 phi is a G2 manifold. Two, the covariant derivative with respect to the Levi-Civita connection of G phi of phi is zero. And three, the holonomy of G phi is contained inside G2. Okay? So the proof of these three things goes, so I'll tell you in words more or less what it is. I'll just write some keywords. So two being equivalent to three is what is known as the holonomy principle. So basically, it tells you that if you have a metric, if you have a connection that admits non-zero parallel spinners, then its holonomy must be contained into a group that stabilizes them. Conversely, if you have a connection whose holonomy preserves some vectors, you can define parallel tensors with respect to that. So it admits parallel tensors that such whose holonomy is contained in that stabilizer. So you just define them at a point, then you define them everywhere by parallel transport. The fact that the holonomy is contained in the stabilizer precisely tells you that that's well defined. The fact that 2 implies 1, so that this equation implies these two ones, basically it's immediate because this contains all the first derivatives of phi. This contains only some of the first derivatives of phi, so that's okay. The fact that 1 implies 2, that gives a bit more work, and it's due to Marisa Fernandez and Alfred Gray in the 70s. Okay, so I'll say 1 implies 2 is Fernandez and Gray. So that's in the 70s. They have more than one paper in the 70s, I'm sorry. I don't know the exact date. Okay, so maybe I'll give you now an historical remark. Tell you something about the history of G2 manifolds. So the classification of Riemannian holonomy groups started in the 20s when Cartan classified symmetric spaces, and so they're Riemannian holonomies. Then in 55, Berger classified the simply connected, irreducible, and non-symmetric Riemannian manifolds, classified their holonomies. So let me put Cartan in the 20s and Berger. In 55. So they classified possible Riemannian holonomy groups. And so Berger gave a finite, well, a list with where all the groups appear in infinite families except for two cases. So there were two exceptional cases. That was the group G2 through representation in dimension 7 and the group spin 7 through representation in dimension 8. So all groups appear
in infinite families, except for two cases, G2 in dimension 7 and spin 7 in dimension 8. And Berger's method to do this consisted on using the Ambrose-Singer theorem to regard the Lie algebra of the holonomy group, so the holonomy algebra, as spanned by the values of the curvature tensor. Then by using the symmetries of the curvature tensor, he got some obstructions that the holonomy algebras needed to satisfy. And with that, he arrived at this list. And at the time, it was not clear whether metrics with these holonomies actually occurred or if it was just an insufficiency of Berger's method that he couldn't rule this out. And in order to clarify that, we had to wait until 1987 when Robert Bryant constructed the first known examples of Riemannian metrics with these holonomies. First examples. But they were, at the time, we didn't know if these were complete or not, so these were possibly non-complete, incomplete. Well, I'll not write that because it actually classifies them. But the first complete examples that we mankind have were given to us by Robert Bryant and Simon Salomon in 89, so the first complete examples. But these were non-compact. But they were explicit. These are explicit, actually, OK? The first compact examples appeared in the 90s through the work of Dominic Joyce in one construction and a separate one by Kovalev, Alexei Kovalev. So these were both in the 90s. So these were the first compact examples. And then in 2013, Corti, Haskins, Nordstrom, and Pacini gave an improvement to Kovalev's construction that allowed to generate a lot more examples. So Corti, Haskins, Nordstrom, Pacini, 2013, substantially improved Kovalev's construction. And I think the number that I've heard is that we have around tens of thousands of examples of this now. And more recently, maybe still this year or next year, we will see some more examples appearing. But a key point of all these constructions is that they are done by gluing theorems where we can think on how these metrics can degenerate, and then we construct these metrics in a region where they are close to degenerating. So for example, Kovalev's construction thinks about manifolds that are developing a very long neck, okay? And then uses asymptotically cylindrical Calabi-Yau to construct this. Okay, so a key feature of this is that we don't have a general existence theorem for this, like Yau's theorem for Calabi-Yau's, okay? No general existence result. And there are a lot of other things that we study on G2 manifolds. They are very interesting gauge fields and submanifolds. I will not tell you about those today, not about the gauge fields, which are my favorite ones. I'll tell you about some of the submanifolds. But we will get there. We will get there, okay? So. Okay, so maybe I'll get there now.
Let me make sure I'm not forgetting nothing I want to tell you. No?
Okay, so I'm about to define some submanifolds of G2 manifolds. So these are four dimensional. Recall that G2 manifolds are seven dimensional. So these are codimension three. So N4 in a G2 manifold is co-associative if I pick my 3 form, I take its odd star, that's a 4 form, and if I restrict it to n, this is the volume form on n with respect to the induced metric. So this is d vol n. Okay. So this condition, not sure you are familiar with these conditions, but this is. So it turns out that this thing here is what is called a calibration in the R-Velozin sense. So these submanifolds, they are calibrated. And in particular, that implies that they are volume minimizing in their homology class. Okay, so are calibrated. In particular, are volume minimizing. They minimize volume in their homology class. Another feature is that they have unobstructed deformation theory. So that's the work of MacLean, unobstructed deformation theory. So this is due to MacLean. And locally, if you have a smooth co-associative manifold, locally co-associative deformations, they form a smooth moduli space of dimension B2 minus n. So I'll write that. Okay. So locally, co-associative deformations form a smooth moduli space of dimension B2 minus n, where B2 minus n is the dimension of a maximal subspace of the second homology where the intersection form is negative definite. Okay, so. And for example, well, we have seen before constructing interesting submanifolds, well, special Lagrangians, by looking at fixed points of involutions. You can do a trick similar to that to find examples of co-associative submanifolds in specific examples. Another thing you can do is to use deformation theorems. For example, if you have an explicit G2 manifold, like one of these that develops a long neck and is given by gluing to asymptotically cylindrical Calabi-Yau three-folds product with S1, one thing you can do is to pick a special Lagrangian you find in one of these, cross it with a circle, and that deforms to a co-associative. Another thing you can do is pick a divisor on your Calabi-Yau, cross it with a point, and that you can also show that deforms to give you a co-associative. So they are not easy to find, but they exist. That's my point. And another thing, if you have one of these manifolds, N4, that defines an homology class in degree 4, and its Poincaré dual, if you have a compact G2 manifold, a class in H3. And questions you can ask is, if given a class in H3, the more ambitious thing you can ask, so I'll decrease my ambition as I go on, okay? So, but here I'm being very ambitious. Oh, well, I'm not, but because I'm not going to try to answer that, but would be to given one of these alphas, one of these class, to develop an enumerative invariant that counts co-associatives in the class alpha. So that's kind of like an analog of Gromov-Witten theory, something like that. Second question, still very, very ambitious, but already a lot less ambitious, would be to ask, well, maybe not less ambitious in some specific cases, you could do A but not B, I don't know, would be to ask the question, is there a co-associative representative of alpha? Even less ambitious would be to say, are there topological obstructions on a certain manifolds on possible co-associative representatives of that class? Okay, that's what I mean. I'll write it. So are there possible, are there topological obstructions on possible co-associative representatives of this class alpha? And C is unambitious in the sense that you can simply do an observation and give a non-empty result regarding it, towards it, which is this proposition I'm about to state. I'm not calling it a theorem because it's really just an observation, so I'll write ops also. So that answers C, in a sense. So if you have X7 phi, a compact G2 manifold, and N is a co-associative representative of a class alpha, then the following happens. You can take the first Pontryagin class, cup it with alpha. So this is a degree 4 cohomology class. That's a degree 3. This is a degree 7 cohomology class. X7 is compact. I can evaluate it against the fundamental form, the fundamental class, sorry. And this is just a number. And this number is equal to 6 times the signature of my co-associative minus 2 times the other characteristics. So tau is the signature of N, and chi is the Euler characteristic. And this is, it's very easy to show this. I'll just do it for you. So what you need to do is to pick this quantity. So which I'll write as the integral over x of p1 of x cup alpha. Alpha is the class Poincaré dual to n. So this is just the integral over n of p1 of x. Then there is this co-associative analog of the adjunction formula that the tangent bundle of x restricts to n as the tangent bundle of n plus lambda 2 minus n. And so you just split the Pontryagin class as p1 of n plus integral of p1 of lambda 2 minus n. And this thing is 3 tau. And this thing is 3 tau minus 2 chi. OK, so that's the end. Okay. So it's just this. So are there any questions so far, by the way? Maybe I'm going too fast. Or no?
Why the dimension? When you write
the dimension of the module? Oh, the dimension of the moduli of local co-associative deformations is b2 minus n. So the dimension of, so the signature is b2 plus minus b2 minus. That's the b2 minus. OK? So it's the dimension of a maximal subspace in the second homology where if you intersect, you get a negative. The intersection pairing is negative. Definite. Are there other questions? Well, no, that's not true. What follows from Thom's theorem is that you can always represent it. You can always represent it by a manifold, by a possibly, it may have singularities. But you can always represent it possibly, not always by a smooth manifold. In this the dimension, in dimension 7.
So are you including singularities?
Well, Here, everything I've done so far possibly includes singularities. All the questions I've read so far, yes, include singularities. What I'll do after, just to make me feel better, will not include singularities, but I didn't work very hard, and I think you can state some of the things I'll write with more generality, okay? Okay, so what I'm about to tell you today is to say, so this thing, if you think about it, B, is kind of like the Hodge conjecture. And what I want to convince you today is that it is more like the Hodge conjecture for 1-1 classes rather than the full Hodge conjecture. And the Hodge conjecture for 1-1 classes is, it's solved, so it's, but it's still very hard in this setting because we don't have algebraic geometry. Yeah, so this is very classical. This appears already in many times in the literature. I didn't even have to compute it. This thing is the thing you need to compute. It's just a characteristic class computation.
But do you use the fact that it is coercive?
Yes, you use it here.
You use it because it's split, but then it doesn't matter.
Yeah, then it doesn't matter. Here is just any form manifold. This is true for any form manifold. Okay, so the idea towards B, or to convince you that B is more or less like the Hodge conjecture for 1-1 classes, is to imitate ideas from complex geometry, namely Lefschetz in 27. So that if X is projective, then there exists, X now is a different thing, this is just Lefschetz theorem. Then there exists a surjective, let me call it M, surjective group homomorphism from the divisors into the Picard group. Okay? And if you put this together with the hard Lefschetz theorem, this is the thing that is hard to prove. The hard Lefschetz is a lot easier. With the Hard-Lefschetz theorem implies the Hodge conjecture for 1-1 classes. And this is actually what, I think I'm not telling any lie to say that this is probably what motivated Hodge to pose the conjecture. So what I'm going to do is to try to find analogs of the divisor group and the Picard group in G2 geometry. And an analog of the divisor group, it's easy to come up with, is this thing. So it's the abelian group of formal finite sums of the form sum of qi and i's, where the qi's are in Z and the ni's are embedded and compact co-associative submanifolds. So if you are worried with representability questions, you can work with rational coefficients instead. But let me not do that. So the second part of my talk is where gerbs come in, and is to try to find an analog of the Picard group in G2 geometry. So the second part, gerbs. Okay, so a gerb, well, is determined, is an object that is determined by a representative of a degree 2 Chekhov cycle with, for the ring of C infinity functions with values in S1. And you should compare this in, so this is, gerbs were invented, I think, from Giroux. And Brilinski. And what you should compare this with is in the same way you construct a circle bundle or an Hermitian line bundle using a degree 1 Chekhov cocycle, where the cocycle there represents the transition functions. Okay? So, but here you use a degree 2. But the thing, the price to pay is that you have to work now on triple intersections, check conditions on 4 intersections, and this thing is not a space in the same sense that the line bundle is over your manifold. But there is another down-to-earth point of view on gerbs that is due to Katerji and Dichin, and this is the approach that I'm going to take. I'll just use this for one more thing today, this approach. So alternatively, so this is due to Katerji and Hitchin. A gerb, and I'll denote my gerbs by a G like that, is determined by the following data. So an open cover U alpha, alpha in some index set I, and now instead of going all the way to triple intersections, I'm going to give you data on double intersections, which are Hermitian line bundles, Hermitian complex line bundles, L alpha beta on the double intersections, U alpha beta. So these denote the double intersections. And L beta alpha, so I'll write the some things with colors, and the things that are in colors, please don't worry about them today. L beta alpha is L alpha beta minus 1. This is not that bad, but it will get bad. And trivializations. Well, not yet. Theta, alpha, beta, gamma, from L alpha beta, L beta gamma, L gamma alpha. So there are tensor products here. This is the trivial complex line bundle. And this satisfies a cocycle condition. OK, so. And the good thing about this in this point of view on gerbs, on how to determine a gerb and on how to work with it, is that you can do gauge theory on them by defining what a connection is on them. Okay, so a connection, using this point of view, a connection, I'll call the connection F on G is determined by these are thetas. I'm sorry, I wrote it fast, so it got a.
Are they maps or
trivializations? They are trivializations. So it's a section of this bundle, if you want. A section with values in the sphere bundle inside these complex line bundles. So this is a line bundle, right? This is a complex line bundle, an Hermitian line bundle. This is an Hermitian line bundle. It's trivial, so it's a morphism of line bundles. But as this is trivial, I call it a trivialization. Okay? A connection F on a gerb given in these terms is determined by the following data. So Hermitian connections. Nabla alpha beta, I'll write it here. Nabla alpha beta on the L alpha beta.
And they satisfy this thing.
Nabla alpha beta gamma theta alpha beta gamma is equal to 0.
So these trivializations here are parallel with respect to the induced connections on the triple tensor products.
And this, oh, this thing happens on these guys are defined on U alpha beta gamma on the triple intersections. I didn't write it, but I hope it was clear. Okay. I didn't write it because I forgot, though. So and two forms, F alpha, on the U alphas, such that if you define these two form, F alpha beta, on such that on the double intersection again, on the U alpha betas, so we define two forms on each open set of the curver, and these two forms are restricted to satisfy some condition on the double intersections, which is this one. If I define the difference of them on the double intersection, then this is the curvature of this connection. Okay? So it's the curvature of Nabla alpha beta.
Sorry, is Nabla alpha beta gamma the induced connection in the test?
Yes. And I keep on breaking your chalk. I'm sorry. OK, so this is what determines a connection there. And now I'm going to give you three remarks. The first one is regarding what is the curvature of a connection on a gerb. So the remark one is that if I go to the double intersections and I think about d of f alpha, this thing is just d of f beta plus d of f alpha beta. Right? But f alpha beta is the curvature of a connection on a line bundle. Right? So this thing is 0 by the Bianchi identity. So the exterior derivatives of these two forms actually agree on double intersections. And that tells me that there is a globally defined three form which restricts to each open set as the exterior derivative of the F alphas. Okay? So there exists, the conclusion is that there exists a globally defined closed three form H such that H restricted to the U alphas is the DF alphas. The second remark, I'm going back to the point of view of gerbs in this way, and is that the long exact sequence induced on in cohomology from the exponential sequence, so remark two, actually gives an isomorphism of H up check two of x infinity s1 with h3 xz. So given a gerb, I can think simply about its image under this map, at least topologically, and I'll call this the first Chern class of a gerb. Okay? And it turns out that independently of the connection that you put there, this cohomology class, well, H represents this class, okay? It's the curvature of any connection lies in there. So it's kind of like Chernval theory for gerbs. Remark three is a construction due to Hitchin, which is actually what led me to think on gerbs, which says that if I have XG, let me call MG, a Riemannian manifold, N, so this n-dimensional, and n minus 3, a codimension 3 submanifold,
oops, and H some closed tree form in the cohomology class of the Poincaré dual of N, then there is a canonical way to define a gerb with connection so GF whose curvature is H. And I'll refer to this construction as Hitchin's construction, okay? So I'm now in shape to tell you what I think is the G2 analog of the Picard group, okay? Which is this. So definition. So, oh, just one remark before proceeding, because I'm going to use it all the time, and the first time I need it is for this definition. It's to say what is a new otherwise I just need to modify the definition by one more condition, but I don't want to explain you what that condition is, and I don't think it's relevant because it's not interesting to work with this more general setting, so I'll just tell you what this is. So an irreducible G2 manifold, so X7 phi, is called irreducible if the holonomy of G phi is actually equal to G2. So if you think about possible Riemannian holonomic groups that are contained in G2, that's SU3, SP1, which is SU2, and the identity, SO4, SO4 is not, and the identity, sorry, SO4 is not, forget what I said, and those other groups, manifolds with holonomy, those other groups are part of a different thing. So, for example, with holonomy 1, just flat torus, if you are thinking about compact manifolds, with holonomy SP1, it's an hypercalor threefold, so compact ones are K3 surfaces, and the flat torus, again, it's reducible holonomy, and SU3 are Calabi-Yau threefolds. And this is really restricting to the interesting G2 manifolds we are trying to study. Okay? So it's not, I'm not trying to cheat here, okay? It's just, this is the interesting thing to do, okay? But it's easy to adapt the definition to the other cases too. Okay? So definition, so X7, an irreducible G2 manifold, then, so a gerb with connection is called a monopole gerb if the following holds. If the following things happen, so first, there exists an open cover, U alpha, together with gerb trivializations, and connection two forms so those F alphas, such that on each U alpha, the following equation holds true. F alpha wedge, sorry, star phi phi. So this is a two form. I wedge it with a four form. I get a six form in seven dimensions. I take its odd star, again, with respect to phi. That's a one form. And I require this to be closed, d sigma alpha for some sigma alpha going from u alpha to r. So that's the first condition. And the second condition is that the curvature of F is harmonic. Okay? So let me, in the following remark, compare this with something that is more familiar. So compared to
the complex analogs that I'm trying to imitate. Okay, so compare with holomorphic Hermitian line bundles on Kähler manifolds. So I like to compare this first condition as the existence of holomorphic trivializations where the connection forms are of type 1-0. Okay? So this is, I compare this with the existence of holomorphic trivializations. And the second condition, I compare with the fact that given an holomorphic line bundle, there exists a unique Hermitian structure whose associated chain connection is harmonic, so has harmonic curvature. Or said in other words, there is a unique connection up to gauge whose curvature is harmonic. Okay, so this is an analog of the, there exists a unique Hermitian structure such that the curvature of the associated churn connection is harmonic. Okay, so are there questions? So I'm going to tell you just two theorems, which are the,
Does the curvature has a special type?
Yeah. So if you are not on an irreducible G2 manifold, I also require that the component of the curvature that lies in the seven-dimensional irreducible G2 representation vanishes, but that condition is vacuous if I'm on an irreducible G2 manifold.
So you could do this for the closed case.
You could do. I don't know how to do this for the co-closed case. You could do the same definition for the closed case if you put this further condition. If you put this further condition on the closed case, yes? Why it's called monopole? First thing is because I like monopoles. Second thing is because this equation here is what I call the G2 monopole equation. So not this one, actually. But if I go to the double intersections and I subtract this equation with the equation for F beta, I guess that the connection on those Hermitian line bundles satisfies what I call the G2 monopole equation. And that's why I call these monopole gerbs.
Let's put it differently. Some brain string theory which gives rise to some monopole
gerb field. Yeah, I don't know nothing about that. Yeah.
You have an ocean, yeah, I know it's not invisible, but if you have a holomorphic gerb on the Galabial threefold, can you pull it back through G21, and would you get this example or not? Is the notion of holomorphic gerb make sense?
I don't know the answer to that question. I've worked out the case of S1 times the Galabial with this further condition that I said, and it turns out that if you have, so one thing that I know that is true is this first next theorem I'm going to write down is that if you start with the co-associative, you get a monopole gerb through which it's construction. But I don't know if the opposite is true. And I worked out the opposite in the Galabial cross S1 case, and the opposite is true in that case. But not always for some cohomology classes that I worked out, yeah. I don't know if this notion agrees with the notion of an holomorphic gerb. Yeah, I mean, this is not what I do for a living. I just noticed this thing, and I thought it was worth doing it. So that's why I don't know the answer to some of your questions. But you are welcome to ask them, and
to give me suggestions. That's why I decided to talk about this here, precisely. Well, there are many examples. I'll tell you that in theorem 2. Okay? So theorem 1 says that if x7 phi is a compact and irreducible G2 manifold, then there is... So let me say one more thing back here in the definition. There are these guys form an abelian group, and these form an abelian group. The monopole gerbs form an abelian group, which I denote M peak X phi. X phi because it depends on X phi, and peak because it's an analog of the Picard group, and M form monopole. So then there is a map. So here, there is a map. It's more than a map. So theorem one is that if I have a compact irreducible G2 manifold, there is a group homomorphism M from the co-associative divisors to M peak. Okay, so, and the here, it's something you can check. It's not exactly what I do at first, but then you can check it a posteriori. It's easier to do it this way. I don't know why. Is that this agrees, this map, M is obtained through Hitchin's construction if you pick the curvature to be the harmonic representative. And theorem 2 is an analog of the Hard-Lefschetz theorem. So theorem 2, so it's an analog of Hard-Lefschetz. Analog of the Hard-Lefschetz theorem. So under the same conditions that x7 phi be compact and irreducible, then the map from M peak x phi to H3 xz that picks a monopole gerb and forgets about the connection and just associates the topological type of the gerb, just associates C1 of G, is surjective. So this tells you that there are lots of examples. Just pick a class, and then you can construct a monopole gerb. It's very easy. It's basically the Poincaré lemma, and then you use direct minimization techniques to solve a PDE. So this is not exactly a PDE yet, but you can transform this into a PDE that you can, of which you can find solutions using direct minimization techniques. And yeah, up to isomorphism, up to the fact, if there exists, up to you, if you can find an open cover and connection to forms such that this holds. Yeah, up to gerb isomorphisms, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah? Yeah, the only bilinear form I can think of is in H2. If you think of P1 of X cup with some beta, wedge some gamma, where beta and gamma are on in degree 2, that's a degree 7 class, and if it's compact, it gives you. And this is negative definite for my conventions, which are different than yours. But it's not with the cohomology class in degree 3. I don't know if this answers your question, but. Okay, so I don't have much time. Basically, I think I'm over it. I'll stay through here. I have some questions I would like to ask people that know about gerbs. So if you are interested in coming talk to me, I would like to ask some questions. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Gonzalo. Questions?